All right, guys, how's it going? At their recent Computex event, AMD has revealed more information on their various upcoming 2016 products, including their 7th generation mobile APU, known as Bristol Ridge. But much more interestingly than that was the information that they revealed on their upcoming Polaris family of GPUs. And predictably, you guys have been clamoring for my take on it ever since. So here it is. A few minutes into the presentation, we finally got to the first Polaris card, the RX 480. Now, obviously, there's been a change of name there. Instead of R9, R7, R5, it now appears to be RX. No doubt AMD will tell us more about this after the NDA lifts at the end of June. Looking at the specs, greater than 5 teraflops, 36 compute units, and assuming AMD keeps the same 64 shaders per CU, that means a total of 2,304. Memory bandwidth is 256 gigabytes per second, with two different memory sizes, 4 and 8 gigabytes of GDDR5. Going on that, we know that they are using the fastest available GDDR5, that is the 8 gigabits per second, the same memory that is on the GTX 1070. It's got a 256-bit bus and what AMD is calling power of 150 watts, something called VR Premium, and it has DisplayPort 1.3, 1.4 compatibility and high dynamic range. AMD is calling it a GPU for the immersive era. On paper, the specs look like it could be pretty similar to the GTX 1070, but the performance of this part is quite a bit below that, and now I will take a look at why that is the case. With their Polaris family, AMD has targeted performance per watt from the outset. You probably know that they had a bit of an issue with power consumption on 28 nanometers, and even though they had some fast cards, the extra power consumption put them well behind Nvidia on performance per watt. So with the move to 14 nanometer FinFETs, AMD has taken the opportunity to fix these issues by really targeting performance per watt. One of the main reasons for their advancement here is the actual FinFETs themselves, and on this slide from the event, you can see that up to 1.7 times the performance per watt comes purely from the move from 28 nanometers down to 14 nanometers. What this effectively means is, you can get the same performance as a 28 nanometer card using around about 70% less power, simply from the FinFETs. However, what AMD claims is that overall, the new Polaris architecture gives up to 2.8 times the performance per watt using what they call AMD technologies. Now, this will be a bunch of hardware and software technologies. AMD puts a lot of effort into power management, especially on their CPUs. But a lot of this stuff can be interchangeable. And at 2.8x, a card like, say, the R9290, which is a graphics card that AMD rates at 275 watts, should now only be using around about 100 watts on the Polaris architecture. So that's the kind of performance we're looking at here. The R9290, maybe the R9390, at around about 100 watts of power. Right, so how did I get to those numbers? Well, we now have one official benchmark from AMD themselves. Rather predictably, they've used Ashes of the Singularity. But what they've done here is they've shown two Radeon RX 480s beating the GTX 1080. Just. At first glance, you might think, well, that's not very impressive. But if you look at the red bar, you can see it says better performance and efficiency. Now, Raja added this GPU utilization number and things got a little bit messy. But as a quick explanation, sometimes when you crossfire GPUs, it's not always easy to get both cards working at 100%. And in one of the benchmarks, the 480s were only running at 51%. So people started thinking, well, if that's the case, then surely one 480 must be about the same speed as one 1080. But that is pretty far from being the case. I don't know if this was a mistake or some bullshit marketing by AMD, but just to clarify what this actually means, we'll take a look at a Reddit post by AMD's technical marketing guy, Robert Hallock. First of all, we thought that scaling was 151% of a single card, but then a bit later he came back and said, in actual fact, talking about the RX 480s, the scaling from 1 to 2 GPUs is 1.83 times. So basically speaking, this 62.5 FPS that we see here from two cards, you need to divide this by 1.83 and that gives you the performance of one RX 480 for a total of 34.15 FPS. So if we now take the 58.7 FPS of the GTX 1080, we can see that the 1080 is 72% faster than the 34.15 FPS of the RX 480. This is probably a good indication of where these cards stand. The GTX 1080 could be 75% faster than the RX 480. Forget any ideas of the RX 480 being a competitor to this card. It's nowhere near it. And by extension, it is also nowhere near the GTX 1070. Now, it's not easy to get an exact comparison of benchmarks because all the websites seem to be doing their own thing. But generally speaking, from what I've seen, the GTX 1080 is around about 22 to 25% faster than the GTX 1070. So let's just apply 22% faster for the GTX 1080 versus the GTX 1070 in Ashes of the Singularity. In that case, the GTX 1070 would have scored 48.1 frames per second. If you now compare that to the 34.1 FPS of the single RX 480, that would mean that the GTX 1070 is around 41% faster overall in Ashes, remember. So that is actually quite a gap. We can actually see the Ashes of the Singularity benchmarks by going to their own site, ashesofthesingularity.com. There is a leaderboard and there is a benchmark. Now, the 34.1 score came from crazy settings on 1080p. If we now select More Filters and DirectX 12, and then select the GPU, and let's choose the GTX 970, we can see that the average FPS here is 31. What is interesting though is this also includes multi-GPU, which is affecting the score in a positive way. If we now compare it to the GTX 980, we can see that that scores an average of 40 frames per second. Once again, this includes multi-GPU scores and also overclocked cards. In this case, on this benchmark, the RX 480 scores just a little bit less than the GTX 980. Again, there are an awful lot of overclocked 980s out there, so we don't know the true picture, but I would not be surprised if the RX 480 is almost identical to GTX 980 performance in this game. And taking a quick look at the R9 390 series, this will include the 390X and the 390. We can see that the average FPS is 39. So once again, this kind of shows that the RX 480 is a card that performs around about the R9 290 level. So you may be thinking, well, that's a bit of a fail. Really, we could be looking at the GTX 1070 being 50% faster overall. So let's just take that number. Why is there such a difference in performance when the specs look the same? Well, mostly it's all about the power. This is a render of the RX 480. And it requires 1/6 pin of power, which you can clearly see here. If we now look at the specs of the GeForce GTX 1070, and then scroll right down to the bottom, we can see that even though the graphics card power in watts is the same at 150 watts, the power connector requirement is an 8 pin. So 6 pin on the 480, 8 pin on the 1070. What this effectively means is they are in two different power performance classes. How this works is, your PC's power unit can supply 75 watts of power through the PCIe slot, three of which you can see on this motherboard, the two red and the black one. But normally for one card, the PCIe slot will provide up to 75 watts of power. Also on your power supply is probably connectors like these. You've got your 6 pin on the left and the 6 plus 2 or 8 pin on the right. So this left one is what you would plug into the RX 480 and the right one is what you would plug into the GTX 1070. The 6 pin only provides up to another 75 watts of power, whereas the 8 pin provides another 150 watts of power. So if you look at it in terms of maximums, this 6 pin here means that the card effectively has 150 watts of maximum power allowable to the card. 75 watts from the connector, 75 watts from the PCIe slot. And obviously the 8-pin connector on the GTX 1070 means the card has a maximum of 150 from this and 75 from the PCIe slot, which equals 225 watts of maximum power. Another way to look at it is, the GTX 1070 is minimum 150 watts, whereas the RX 480 is a minimum of 75 watts. While not entirely accurate, it will do for this video. So as you can see, these two cards are in different power and performance classes. So a 50% gap may not be as bad as it sounds, but that really does depend on which range this card falls into. For example, if the true power draw of this card was only 75 watts, then even though the GTX 1070 is 50% faster, it would still require twice the power to be 50% faster, meaning that the AMD card has much, much better performance per watt. The flip side is also true. If the RX 480 is drawing around 150 watts of power, while the GTX 1070 is 50% faster, then clearly Nvidia has a large lead at around about the same power, which is not so good for the AMD card. So how do we know what the true power value of this card is? Well, taking a look at the earlier slide should give us a good idea. And this is the slide that gives the game away. If you remember at the start, I said not only do the RX 480s have better performance, they also have better efficiency, which simply means they have better performance per watt. We already know know that the GTX 1080 is a 180-watt rated card and typically draws around about 170 watts in a gaming load. But if we just assume for this case that AMD has chosen a GTX 1080, which actually draws 180 watts of power while gaming, in order to find out the watts of one of these RX 480s, we do the following calculation. It is simply 62.5 divided by 58.7. That gives us 1.065, at which point we simply divide the GTX 1080's power draw of 180, we divide that by 2 to give us 90, and then multiply the 1.065 by that 90 to give us 96 watts of power. 96 watts for a graphics card that is basically equivalent to an R9290 level of graphics card. There is no other way to get these numbers that make sense. It is even possible that the card only draws 90 watts maximum power. If we assume that the GTX 1080 draws about 170 watts, then in order for both of these RX 480s to win in efficiency, they must draw a maximum of 90 watts while gaming. This really does look like amazing efficiency from these cards. So the performance may not be all that exciting, but the performance per watt is certainly on a very high level. And here's the thing about Polaris. From the very start, AMD said that they were targeting low power, affordable gaming for the masses, especially in terms of virtual reality, which I will touch on later as soon as I know more about the virtual reality capabilities of the card. But AMD dropped a real bombshell by pricing this card at $199. That's for the 4GB version, however, with the 8GB version coming in, we believe, at $229. So we could be talking maybe around about GTX 980 performance level for a couple of $100. It is fantastic value for money as well. They did, however, mention the $100 to $300 range. So if you think about it, Polaris 11, the very small GPU, should be priced at $100 and $150. Two desktop graphics cards based on the same very small Polaris 11 GPU. So you could be looking at your 470X and your 470. And the one we know for sure about is, of course, the RX 480 that we're talking about here. But if the RX 480 is a maximum of $229, then which card costs $299? And here's the thing. Right at the very end, AMD's CEO reiterated the $100 to $300 price points, which really does make you think there must be another card above this RX 480. And if we look at the history of it, around about 4.5 years ago, AMD launched their Pitcairn class of graphics cards, which is the same kind of class of graphics card as this. So that was the HD 7850 and the HD 7870. The HD 7850 had one single 6-pin connector, whereas the HD 7870 had two 6-pin connectors. Now, two 6-pins and one 8-pin are exactly the same. They both provide another 125 watts to a graphics card. If we go even further back, when AMD launched their BART series, that is their 6800 series, the 6850 had one 6-pin and the 6870 had two. And if you go back to the 4870 and the 4850, you've got the exact same story. AMD likes to have their single 6-pin and their double 6-pin cards. And to be frank, I do not believe that AMD created Polaris simply for one 90-watt graphics card. It just doesn't make any sense. And the final clue for me is in the name, the RX 480. As far as I'm concerned, this is AMD hiding their intentions. It's a much smarter name as well. I do like it compared to the old R9, R7, R5s. But you're never going to have a card called the RX 480X. That just does not roll off the tongue. So there will not be an RX 480X. What I believe you're going to see instead is the RX 490. Because the gap between this RX 480, this very low power 90 watt graphics card, and its bigger brother, built on the same GPU, Polaris 10, possibly having a power allowance of over 150 watts. And we also believe, instead of just the 36 compute units, it will probably have 40 for 2560 shaders. If you give this RX 480 another 50-60 watts of power and another 11% more shaders, then you now have a graphics card that should be very, very close to the GTX 1070 for only $300. And this is what I believe AMD is doing here. AMD got really stung by the reputation of having hot and power-hungry cards. This RX 480 is AMD proving that they are capable of doing very low power at very good performance. The RX 490, however, is likely to have not quite so good power characteristics and may even suffer in terms of performance per watt compared to the GTX 1070. But at $300, instead of $380, there is a good chance that it will be compelling enough. So this is AMD's small power efficient card, which should overclock very, very well indeed. And I believe the RX 490 is a GTX 1070 rivaling card that AMD has kept under wraps all of this time and will be released at some point after the RX 480. It just doesn't make sense to make this one card, the RX 480, at such a low wattage and not have a much more higher performing card, basically in the tier above as the RX 490. My overall suspicion is that AMD has really closed the gap. The RX 490 will be very, very close to the GTX 1070, but maybe just not quite, and Nvidia will still have the better performance per watt. But overall, it's a massive improvement for AMD, and at $300, it's really what the market needs to give it a bloody good shake. We shall see. Right, so let me know what you think about this one in the comments below. Obviously, there's one or two more things I can talk about, but that'll be in a different video. There's a bunch of links in the description below as usual, and I will catch you later, guys.